Today we're talking about these new antitrust things that you've probably started hearing about. As if recent politics could use any less trust. So what the heck am I talking about? Because nobody's mentioned antitrust laws since this political cartoon was meant to make Teddy Roosevelt look like a good guy. Ah, that bear is way too cute to be a bad trust. A trust is essentially a monopoly, and we're going to be talking about three things today. What is antitrust? Because that name certainly wasn't created by a PR team. My campaign is going to be dedicated to opposing trust at all levels of government. Why is it entering the conversation to do? And what does the law say about the government coming in and breaking up or preventing mergers of private companies? Because you better believe we have a long history of companies' investors saying, yeah, maybe you don't do that. So first question, what is trust and why are politicians so against it nowadays?
With machines expediting labor, businesses like Rockefeller Standard Oil and Carnegie Steel Company became so large that they shut out any competition. They were called trusts back then, but today we call them monopolies. Monopolies can force consumers to pay higher prices and make it impossible for other companies to enter the market.
Well, that summed it up pretty well. A trust is a company that has either crushed, acquired, or crushed, then acquired all of its major competition. Basically, imagine you're playing a board game and one person wins. If you were to keep playing at that point, that's what an economy with a trust would look like. They set the prices, because who else are you gonna go to? And they lower innovation, because again, who else are you gonna go to? Now, and this is probably gonna be a surprise for exactly nobody, but we have a very different monopoly problem today than we did at a time when we were worried about American trains and steel being too successful of industries. So why are we talking about antitrust today? Well, the main reason is...
splitting up the biggest names in Silicon Valley. That's the idea thrown out from the Democratic 2020 White House hopeful, Senator Elizabeth Warren. She's proposing to break up big tech companies.
That's right. Warren is pushing to break up big tech companies, she said on Twitter. Weird place to announce your anti-tech monopoly policy. That's like complaining about the vaping problem through jewel-based smoke signals. Still, this has got many people thinking maybe she's onto something. Immediately, there are some interesting changes, because Google, Facebook, and Amazon are free, or somewhat free services, in an industry with a low barrier to entry. I mean, you can find articles from 2007 asking, will MySpace ever lose its monopoly? For all you young viewers, yes, at one point we were worried about MySpace having a monopoly on people's data. And Blockbuster Video is going to dominate the movie industry. I mean, did you hear? They're introducing their own streaming service. So this brings us to an important question. How is this different? I mean, it's a lot easier for me to start my own social media website than it is for me to decide to start a steel company. Well, all monopolies are created differently, and we're going to be dealing with two different types of monopolies today. Horizontal integration and vertical integration. We'll start with Amazon.
You want to run a platform? That's fine. You don't get to run a whole bunch of the businesses as well. You want to run a business? That's fine. You don't get to run the platform. Think of it this way. It's like in baseball. You can be the umpire, or you can own one of the teams, but you don't get to be the umpire and own the teams.
This is vertical integration. Basically, you start out as a person whose idea is to sell books on a website. Wow, sounds like you're going to be the next billionaire. A vertical integrator would say, people seem to like this marketplace. Let me start my own brand so I can start selling my products on this marketplace. And then maybe I'll start my own shipping company. Amazon hasn't gotten into the factory game yet, but you see my point. It would be like if Apartments.com started a construction company, or if Craigslist decided to become a pimp. You can start your own website to compete against Amazon, but if you have to work with somebody else's shipping company, somebody else's products, or somebody else's marketplace, it's gonna be a bit harder to compete. Especially because I'm guessing Amazon Shipping is going to give Amazon Marketplace a bit of a better deal than they'll be giving somebody else. And Amazon Basics brand will definitely give Amazon's Marketplace a better deal on products than they'll give your website. Now you may be watching this and thinking, But Stephen, what about Amazon streaming, Amazon Prime, and Amazon pretty much everything else nowadays? But those frills aren't what are concerning the antitrusters. It's this complete control of the pipeline from factory to consumer. And this brings us to horizontal immigration and the Facebook problem.
The giant tech companies right now are eating up little tiny businesses, startups, and competing unfairly.
While a company like Amazon can start producing products and create a shipping company, since laws passed saying it's illegal to own humans, it's a little harder for Facebook and other social networking sites to seize their own means of production. Unless Facebook wanted to start owning influencers, the pipeline from a person posting something to you seeing it is pretty shallow. That's why their strategy is to buy everything that could one day become more successful than them. Or, as Warren puts it, they buy potential rivals, like Facebook did with Instagram and WhatsApp, limiting innovation and choice. This is where things start to get tricky, because unlike Amazon, where you're the consumer, on Facebook you're the product and advertisers are the consumers. The goal here is essentially to make life as confusing as possible for baby boomers. Oh, you don't have a Facebook? Well, okay, how about a WeChat? Nope. Oh, you're primarily on KakaoTalk. Now, I've never actually gotten around to making an account on that one. Meet you on QQ. Or if you feel like getting away from everybody, we could just always go to the ghost town that is Google Hangouts or any of the other 60 plus social networking sites you need to be on nowadays. Tell you what, I'll just call you. So why is a world in which you have more social networking sites than you have friends a utopia we're striving for?
Nikki said he has felt that big tech is monopolistic, it is hurting the democracy, it is hurting competition and hurting open markets. And I think on that hurting competition, that could actually garner, that's the part of the argument that I feel like is probably most dangerous for big tech.
Again, this horizontal integration problem is a little harder to explain because we're the product. But essentially, we want more free-range internet users as opposed to caged internet users. If you don't agree with Facebook using your data to sell ads, which, gee, you found out I would like The Economist. Good job cracking that code. Then you should have a platform where you can ignore totally random and unoptimized click ads, as opposed to ignoring the tailor-made ads that Cambridge Analytica put so much effort into making sure you'd like. If you don't agree with Facebook's data policies, you'd be hard-pressed to find a social media website with better practices that any of your friends are on. And if one ever did come out, Facebook can just cut that founder a check for $19 billion without batting an eye. So the real goal here is more social networking sites with more different privacy policies and content display styles. So you, as the product, can figure out which marketplace you want to dedicate your time to. That's right, you're valuable. Don't be the Chanel number 5 behind a lockbox at a CVS at a steep discount. Let your consumer flag fly. Now to the final question of the night, how?
Not only is she complaining about big tech, but she actually has a how-to, step-by-step, this is what we would do. So I'll go through the three steps.
Like all good plans, it's three-pronged. Although the first two are almost indistinguishable to someone who did not watch the first part of this episode. First, you have an attack against the horizontal integrators, like Facebook, who are buying up competitors like they're going out of style. Specifically, she's targeting Facebook's acquisition of Instagram and WhatsApp, and wants to bring in new regulators to split up these companies. Because, while in Europe these platforms aren't allowed to share data, in America, well, if you're ever feeling lonely or unimportant, just know that someone's reading your texts. This split would increase competition, diversify privacy measures, and could lead to more innovation in social media, as those leaders of industry compete with each other for us. The second prong would limit these larger companies from owning a marketplace and selling items on that marketplace. It would break up Amazon and Amazon Basics, and in a Fox News joke worthy of a shout-out,
she wants to undo the Google Nest merger, which actually I was like, maybe Google's gonna think that's a favor, but anyway, that's a different story.
Ew! Somewhere out there, my dad is laughing really hard. This would break up these companies so they can't own the products and the free marketplaces in which your products would be competing with other people. And don't worry, your family-owned website that sells home-owned frames isn't going to get shut down over this war on legislation. Unless your business is doing really well. Because only those companies that have an annual global revenue of $25 billion or more would be required to structurally separate their products from their marketplace. And the final prong is...
And then the third prong is essentially preventing these companies from sharing or selling third-party data.
Think about it.
See, me and everybody else who wants to put their stuff in front of you can just fill out an audience targeting analytics list and the tech companies will figure out everything else for us. We're not all evil. Oh, you want to put your stuff in front of 35-year-olds who recently moved, earned this much money, and have a dog with three legs. Well, there are 20,000 people who live like that, so we'll show them your ad. What Facebook was doing was, with companies like Cambridge Analytica, instead of keeping the data and making you fill out questions to target an audience, they just sold massive Excel spreadsheets of data to companies so that they could figure it out on their own. This would make that second part illegal. Not exactly an antitrust point, but you really have to round out that third prong to give it a three-pronged satisfactory feeling. So that's why you're probably going to be hearing about antitrust again soon. Here's an idea of how to really stick it to the man, though. Share this video on Facebook, Google-owned YouTube, and every other social media-owned monopoly out there. Really take them down from the inside. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello, YouTube. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan news, remember to subscribe by clicking on this floating logo to the right of my head. Ring that bell so that freedom will continue to ring, and give me a thumbs up if you like what you saw. Lastly, as always, thank you for watching.